Hi, welcome to another episode of the Guys' Book Club in the World. Thank you, Book Club. Yay! And today, guys, we're on an extremely special episode because today, guys, we're on episode number 144, guys. 144. We are so close to get to one episode, two episode, and 150, guys. 150 episodes on the channel. It's going to be crazy, crazy, crazy. And guys, and you know it's so crazy that you see this dragon behind me and he's a warrior. They're like, yeah, like crazy, crazy, crazy. So let's go, let's go, let's go. And guys, they're very exciting, and I'm also excited, very excited about the fact that we almost get into 150 episodes. And I'm also excited because it's episode number 144, which means tomorrow is going to be the binge watch party time. So let's go, let's go, let's go. Binge watch party time. So let's go, guys. Let's go, let's go, let's go. And guys, welcome to the channel. And guys, welcome to the channel. If you're new to the channel, welcome. And if you're already familiar with the channel, welcome back. My name is Zeki, and I'm the host. And on this podcast, on this book club, we're working together on English speaking level and reading level, and on communication skills to stand in front of the camera and to communicate well for the camera. I'm doing so because I truly believe that English is the number one tool that each one of us must acquire in order to be successful in life. And a second tool that it's going to help us a lot is to know how to communicate well on the camera. You might probably ask me why we should want to know how to communicate well on the camera, or why we should want to know how to speak in English. And the answer is because if you know how to communicate well on the camera, and if you know how to communicate well in English on the camera, you can have an access to almost anyone around the world. Ask me how you can do it. And the answer is with this device. Guys, if you know how to make content to this little device, a smartphone, you can communicate with almost everyone around the world, because English is the international language, and almost everyone around the world has this device. And the statistics about how much time people are consuming content on YouTube, on Facebook, on Instagram, on social media, are always rising. Always rising up and coming up. And if you know to make good quality and good quality content for those social media platforms, you can communicate with almost everyone. So just do it, guys. And you see, if you want to get this great breakdown behind me, you can find it on, 3, 2, 1, go, bam, you can find it on Good Fun. And this great background was created by Cisco, 1701, on 17 on January 2020. And of course, guys, we leave a thumb up because we really love this great background. And if you want to get the full resolution of the picture, just left click on the picture, double left click, and kabam, right click, Shimrat Tmonot B'Shem or Save Picture As. And just like that, you can download the picture to your computer. So great background. Thank you very much for Cisco for making it. Yeah, I highly recommend you to check them out. And guys, and today we are continuing our journey with the Art of the Deal by Donald J. Trump. And to tell you the truth, guys, today is the last episode before the last episode, because tomorrow we are going to finish the book. And it was a great ride, a great journey with the Art of the Deal by Donald J. Trump. And on this book, Donald J. Trump tells us the stories about how he became successful, an entrepreneur and a construction builder, and in New York City. This was the book was written, I think, in 1978, 79. And by telling us those stories, Donald J. Trump teaches us a lot of life, both important life lessons that help him to get successful, and I learned a lot from this book so far. And I implemented some of the life lessons that Trump teaches us into my own life. And so, guys, if you want to check out Donald J. Trump, which was the former president of the United States, social media account, or if you want to get this great breakdown, you got all the link right down in the description below. So make sure to check them out. And also, if you like the channel, if you like the podcast, please like the video, subscribe to the channel, of course, press the notification bell so you will be notified when each new exciting episode are coming to YouTube. And of course, guys, if you can comment below about something you used to learn from this episode, episode the channel at all. And if you have any recommendations for me, what I should do, how can I improve, what should be the next books that are going to me together on this channel, please let me know also in the comment below. So guys, just to let you know, the date today is 4th of July 2021, and the time now is 8:13 in the morning a.m. And yeah, trying to work on myself, to coach myself and my friend. They are trying to become better. Young King Show. And I'm trying a process now. And in the... And I think in a future videos, I will tell you more about it. So guys, let's go, let's just go to the book, because this is what we are coming from, right? To learn from Donald J. Trump. So the Art of the Deal by Donald J. Trump, page 275, read by the myth, the legend, the one and only. The one and only, your boy, give me some time, please. Your boy, AK, let's go, that's me, so let's go. And today, Trump is going to finish the book, the story about how he built this television city. In any case, the city was also stonewalling my project as a means of trying to force me to make changes. In my view, it was a form of economic blackmail. So long as I resisted the ideas, they held up my approvals. And my cost mounted. Specifically, city planning wanted me to provide more direct access to the waterfront, add more east-west streets connecting the project to the existing city street grid, and move the world's tallest building south, away from the existing residential neighborhoods. I disagreed with those suggestions. But I also recognize that zoning is always a matter of negotiation. A sound as I push, in the end, I'm practical. If it took making some compromises to get the project moving forward, and the result didn't undermine the project's economic viability, I was prepared to make the changes. In March, I decided to move the location of the world's tallest building south to 63rd Street. The people at the city planning were immediately more enthusiastic. Around the same time, the New York Times had made public environmental impact study of the site. Some of its conclusions, I felt, would ultimately help my case. I had always believed that any concern about destiny were unwarranted. In truth, the west side of Manhattan is relatively underpopulated. According to the census, they have a decline in population from 245,000 in 1960s to 204 in the 1980s. Only 3,100 new apartments went up in the neighborhood between 1980s and 1984. Adding several thousands more hardly represents development landmark. The study also pointed out several benefits that will come from the project. For example, the study predicted that the West Side would gain business worth at least $500 million a year from new residents, as well as tens of thousands of jobs, both during construction and permanently on the site. Providing jobs, in my view, is a far more constructive solution to unemployment than creating welfare programs. Finally, the study found that any added vehicular congestion in the area, a major concern among some critics, could be eased by improvements in local subways and the addition of a jitney service, which I had already proposed. Even after moving the location of the world's tallest building, I began to believe that I might also have to make a change in architects. I like the fact that Olmert John was an outsider, but I think it taught us with the people at City Planning. No one in the commission ever seemed quite comfortable with Olmert. It was never anything more specific than that. But in the end, I felt that was enough. If the project was going to move forward, there had to be some spirit of cooperation. Reluctantly, I decided to make a change. A lot of people were surprised that I chose Alex Cooper, even more than Richard Mayer. Cooper was John's antithesis, legendarily civic-minded. He had built his reputation as an urban planner, served 5 years on the city planning commission, and helped write the rules of the planning process I was now going for. Along with his partner at the time, Stanton Ekstut, Cooper had just finished work on the master plan for a development at the southern tip of Manhattan called Battery Park. The critics love it, calling it a classic example of enlightened urban architecture. I wasn't a total fan of the Battery Park project itself. For example, while the project was situated on the waterfront, many of its apartments faced other buildings and therefore had no better views at all. In addition, I felt that a number of the buildings were totally undistinguished architecturally. However, Cooper's contributions to the master plan, the placement of streets, parks, and other amenities, I did like, and I felt it could bring some of those ideas to our site. As first interviewed Cooper in October 1988, shortly before going public with the Elmont John plan for the site. There were already indications that the city might have problems with the way we had designed our open space, and I was interested in hiring Cooper to work with John just on that. Working together didn't appeal to either of them, however, so I put the idea on the back burner. I caught Cooper again in May 1986 and offered him the chance to take over sole responsibility for the television city job. In my opinion, he was the guy best positioned to get my project moving forward. As for him, although he might have been on different sides of the fence in the past, what smart, ambitious architect could pass up such an opportunity? Television City was probably the best and most challenging design job available anywhere. It was about time I challenged Alex that he got associated with something big and bold, instead of small and precious. To his credit, Alex jumped at the opportunity. My God, he told the reporter later. It is 3/4 of a mile of Hudson frontage, so you don't lightly just walk away. We had our differences, but I quickly discovered that Alex and the far grander instincts than many people realized, and we got along better professionally than most people assumed we would. Alex said that more streets and pedestrian always providing direct access for the project to the smartphone. He designed parks that were easily reached by anyone coming from outside. We agreed to increase the number of buildings and to make each of one a little smaller. In front of the taller buildings, Alex said that townhouses as a way of varying the scale. What Alex didn't do was substantially reduce the amount of overall square footage below what I believed was necessary to ensure the project's economic viability. Still, his changes plainly had an impact. Suddenly, we started getting more positive feedback from city planning. When we unveiled the plan publicly on October 23, 1986, even our toughest critics were more enthusiastic than they had been about the original plan. The head of the local community board, John Cowan, still objected to the super skyscraper, but he described Alex's new approach as a brilliant answer to Trump's desires and a far better plan. Cooper himself, who had been skeptical of the size of the project at first, grew more enthusiastic as he got more involved in the design. In April 1987, he told the New York Times, "I hope that the project can be dealt with on its merits. The problem is that the anti-development spirit in this city is very, very strong right now. What we are trying to do at a television city is different. There is room by the river, and we are providing a level of public amenity that makes this immense size justifiable. Parks, waterfront promenades, and so forth. The world's tallest building demands an extraordinary situation. But if there is any place that such a skyscraper makes sense, it is there. It is here. I couldn't have said it better myself. As for attracting NBC to the site, I felt our cars got a boost when General Electric approached RCA, owner of NBC, in mid-1986. I knew Jack Welch, Jr., the chairman of GE, General Electric, and he struck me as a brilliant big thinker who would immediately see the advantage of locating NBC on a site like Television City. Welch went on to name Bob Bright, one of his top GE executives, to head NBC, and I got the same feeling about Bright. They are exceptional men. Even if they don't choose my site. At the time GE took over, NBC had been actively considering no less than four New York City sites, in addition to the one in New Jersey. In January 1987, NBC announced that aside from the possibility of remaining at the Rockefeller Center, they narrowed their choice to just two sites, ours and the marshland owned by Arts Mountain Industries in Secaucus, New Jersey. Eliminated from the competition were three other New York City sites. The result was to make the issue very simple. Either NBC came to my site, or they moved to New Jersey. The city had already announced a willingness to offer NBC tax concessions, mostly in the form of property tax abatements, as an inducement for the network to remain in New York. The question now was whether they offer a package competitive with New Jersey's proposal. Incredibly, the city seemed content to sit back and do nothing. I say incredible, I say incredible, because in early 1987, Mobil Oil, one of the largest corporations in the world, announced that it was abandoning New York and moving to Virginia. A short time later, J.C. Penney, another huge employer, revealed that it too was leaving, and taking along many thousands of jobs. You would think the city, faced with yet a few big company threatening to leave, would spring to action. Not under Ed Koch, however. In late February 1987, the Daily News ran an editorial that I thought captured the dilemma perfectly. After suggesting that the loss of NBC would be a major blow to the city, an enormous loss of jobs, revenues, and prestige, the editorial addressed the significance of my site. Television City is far from a certainty, it said. The project must work its way through the city approval process. But anything from bureaucratic inertia to political cowardice can kill it. That is not a case for city hall, the blandly accepting Trump's plan in toto. But it is an argument for swiftness and efficiency in making crucial yes or no decisions. The goal of city policy must be to keep NBC on. The worst possible result would be to lose it to cowardice. In my view, that is precisely what was happening. And in May 1987, I went to the city with a proposal for a tax of my abandonment program that would make it possible for me to offer NBC a deal competitive with New Jersey. Larry Townsend, the city's head of economic development, had said herself that without abandonment, NBC stood to save up to $2 billion over a 20 year period by moving to New Jersey. Damn, that's a lot of money. I suggested a deal under which I would build the NBC's headquarters myself at a cost of between $300 million and $400 million. I would also subsidize the NBC's rent for 30 years by charging only $15 a square foot, which is less than half the break-even rent. Finally, I would agree to give to the city 25% of my profits at Television City earned for a period of 40 years. In return, I would get a 20-year tax abandoned on my entire site. Even then, my saving would begin only when I got the project up, which was years away, at best. In the meantime, I would be subsidizing NBC out of my own pocket to the tune of at least $30 million a year. Ironically, there was almost total opposition to my firm within my own organization. Robert Harvey Freeman and Norman Levine felt that for me to agree to give NBC $30 million a year in subsidies before we knew what revenues would be earning was too great a risk. My feeling was that the risk was worth taking. A tax abandoned for residential apartments would make them more marketable. In addition, NBC would be a prestigious addition to the site. And the law, for the city, it was no loss. They put up no money at all to keep NDC, and in lieu of taxes, they would share a substantial percentage of any profits we ultimately earned. My proposal sparked the first serious negotiations we had with the city. Etco didn't participate, but the city officials under him seemed receptive to the general structure of the plan. On May 25, however, after more than 3 weeks of intense negotiations, Edcoch turned the deal down cold. I am convinced that he made the determination not on the merits, but also because he didn't want to make any deal with me, no matter how good it was for the city. The next day, I wrote Edcoch a letter that I would held off writing for more than a year. Dear Ed, it said, your attitude on keeping NBC in New York City is unbelievable, and I predict, we need to NBC leaving the city, as so many other major companies have, for New Jersey. I again ran down the benefits of keeping the network, and ended by saying, I'm tired of sitting back quietly and watching New Jersey and other states drain the lifeblood out of New York. Coach replied exactly the way I expected him to. He refused to respond to my specific points, and he tried to burn the issue into a personal content of Vils. Coach is a great protector against Trump, the greedy developer. For months, he had been looking for a way to get back at me for embarrassing him by building Walmart Link so quickly and efficiently. The best side yard, he apparently decided, was a perfect vacation. When I came back with yet another suggestion for saving NBC, sending 9 acres of my site at below my cost directly to the city, Coach rejected it without so much as a discussion. I can't say I was surprised when the New York Times came out against my plan. The writer of the editorial was a long-time coach, Eli Herb Stars, until joining the Times editorial board only a few weeks earlier. Stars had been head of the City Planning Commission, with specific responsibility for Television City. In my view, letting Herb Stars write editorials about New York City is analogous to permitting Casper Weinberger to write editorials about Morgan's military policy. I did gain strong editorial support, however, from the Daily News. The mayor is correct in saying there are limits to how much the city can give NBC, the news wrote. But that is no excuse for inaction. Coach would personally bring together the decision makers for NBC, Rockefeller Center, and Trump's outfits. He should lay out a strong plan and knock it if that is what it takes. Instead, Coach offered NBC a Yelp asset, watered down a tax abandonment proposal, which he said they could apply at any Manhattan site they choose. He even offered a little free advice about some new sites they might consider. Free advice, of course, tends to be worth what you pay for it. No sooner did Coach make his suggestion than an NBC spokesman said the network wasn't interested in considering more sites. In the meantime, the executives at Arts Mountain Industries weren't sitting idly by, recognizing an opportunity to force NBC's end. They announced on June 1st that the network had 30 days to accept the terms that they were offering and which New York was no longer willing to match. There were some who told me that I was upping my chances for zoning approval by talking on a coach in the media. They might well have been right, But I felt there was a bigger issue to at stake. I've come to believe that coach is so incompetent and destructive to New York that someone has to stand up and say no and say so publicly. When the Daily News polled its readers as to whether they agreed with coach's position on NBC or with mine, the results were very satisfying. Nearly 10,000 people, 10,000 readers, sided with me. Only 1,800 went with coach. I waited a long time to build it on the west side, and I can't wait longer to get the zoning I feel is necessary. In the end, I will build Television City without NBC and without the current administration. I continue to keep all my other options open to, because as I have said, it is the only way you truly protect yourself. If the residential real estate market remains strong, I will undoubtedly do very well selling large Riverview apartments in that location. If the market generally falls, and that can only be temporary in a city like New York, I might choose to build only the shopping complex. I will do very, very well just with that. My time in Television Cities will come. I'm lucky that I can afford to wait, because that way I will be able to do it right. The bad thing I know is that I will be doing business in New York City long after head coach has moved out of a Gracia mansion. So guys, this was the episode of today. And it was very nice. I thought that Trump would rebuild the Television City, but no. We finished the book with tension. We don't know how it came out. Now I think we can choose. Let's check. Let's check it on Google. Let's check on Google again. And let's see. Let's see if this is the only definitive project in the location square on the west side. From the return location construction. The 1997 used the residential. Yes, so Trump managed to do it. You can see on 1997. It looks nice. Tall buildings, the river, parks, good for Trump. So guys, this was the episode today. I really hope that you enjoyed this episode. And of course, you know, tomorrow is a binge party time, and this tomorrow we are going to finish the book. So stay tuned for tomorrow episode. Guys, I just want to know that I really appreciate the fact that you choose to invest your time with me. So thank you very much. So guys, go out and explore the world, make a difference because we're in. And as Trump said, you can wait, just work on your skills. Like Robin Sharma said, hard work plus focus plus time equal mastery. So take your time, work on yourself, but keep working on yourself. Because you see, right now I'm working on myself, I'm working on my skills to stand in front of the camera, to communicate well, to speak in English. I need books that I'm going to expand my mind, to make me smarter, to make me better. And I take my time for that, guys. 144 episodes today. You see, and I'm planning to do much more episodes to achieve 1,000 episodes. I wish. I want to achieve at least 1,000 episodes. I think it's going to be great to change it. 999, 1,000. So let's go, let's go, let's go, let's go. It's going to take us some years, but we are going to achieve it, guys. And you see, just wait for the right time, and the right time will come. As long as you will prepare yourself, when the opportunity will come, and it will come, because all of us got opportunities. All of our lives, we got new opportunities. And the difference is between, are you ready for the opportunity or not? Can you recognize the opportunity or not? And by working each day to become smarter, to become wiser, to learn something new, we are growing our ability to recognize opportunities and to take them and to make them right. So guys, go and spend the world, make a difference, because we're real. And guys, have a great time with your family, friends, and neighbors. And if you are in an area where the coronavirus is still going, please stay home, stay safe. I think this coronavirus is behind us, because we are aware in like a book club, a family, like a book club community, of the fact that a lot of people got sick from the coronavirus, or my lost loved ones to the coronavirus. And just want you know, guys, to know that we are sending our best wishes for you guys, and we are praying for you to feel better, to become better, and have better days. And guys, if any one of you want to come to the podcast, to be a guest on the podcast, and to chat me, to chat, or maybe share a story with the world, and share a message with the world, please let me know in the comments below so we can arrange it. So guys, thank you very much. I really hope you see all tomorrow, guys, for the last episode of the week, the Binge Party Time, and the last episode of the new series, The Art of Dealing by Donald J. Trump. So guys, see you soon. See you tomorrow. Until then, have a great time. Take care of yourself, and bye-bye.